Welcome back after that short break. We have a session by Ms. Urvashi Prasad. Ms. Urvashi Prasad is the Director, Development, Monitoring and Evaluation Office, DMEO at Niti Aayog Government of India. She is a person with extensive experience in health, nutrition, sanitation, gender and public policy. Over the last 5 years, working as a public policy specialist in the office of the Vice Chairman at Niti Aayog, the premier policy think tank of the Indian government, providing policy and directional inputs in a variety of economic and social sectors. Currently part of the core team supporting the work of Government of India's Empowered Group 1 for managing the COVID-19 pandemic in the country. She has over 100 publications in leading national and international newspapers, journals, and digital platforms. Member of the World Economic Forum's Expert Network and an alumnus of the World Economic Forum's Global Shapers Community. Member of the Task Force for Overseeing the Implementation of Sustainable Development Goals in India and co-authored India's first voluntary national review presented at the United Nations High-Level Political Forum on Sustainable Development in 2017. Have extensive programmatic and policy experience in areas that fall under SDGs 2, 3, 5 and 6 in particular. Thank you so much for joining us. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you. I wanted to highlight a few key aspects in relation to SDG2, which is on hunger and nutrition, and really speak in the Indian context in terms of, you know, what we need to focus on from a policy perspective, how we need to look at good practices, and how do we need to implement them across the country. So these are some of the aspects that I will be speaking about today. So I think, you know, this is a very, very important SDG, especially in the Indian context, where we have a significant challenge when it comes to nutrition, and we have a significant challenge of malnutrition. Now, of course, there are different aspects to this. One is hunger and an extreme hunger. And I would say that there we have made a fair amount of progress over the years, in the sense that at least in terms of our production capabilities, our ability to produce adequate food grains or ensure an adequate supply of food, we have definitely achieved quite a bit of progress on that front. The challenge that we face in a country like India is getting this supply to the people who need it. Distribution is actually where we find a lot of our challenges. A lot of the food actually gets wasted. A lot of the food grains get wasted because we are not able to get it to the right people in the right time frame. So that, for a country like India, the biggest challenge is now it's not just about supply, but actually much more on distribution, getting it to people who need it within the right sort of time frame. So that is, I think, our issue when it comes to hunger. But much more than hunger is the challenge of malnutrition. And that is obviously something where people might be getting adequate quantities of food, but somewhere the quality of the food they are consuming, the quality of the calories that they are taking in is not what it should be. So that is obviously the biggest challenge for India. It's a very, very long-standing challenge. And I feel that, you know, it's absolutely critical if we are to move forward as an economy as well. You know, often we look at these SDGs, often we look at sectors like nutrition and health and refer to them as social sectors. But just as the pandemic has shown us that these are sectors which are absolutely crucial for the economy as well. If you want to have a productive, engaged workforce, you need them to be healthy. You need them to be well nourished. So we need to look at these SDGs and in these sectors equally from the economic perspective, and not just from a social or a societal perspective. So malnutrition, we actually have a twin burden that we are now dealing with. We are dealing with both ends of the spectrum. We are still grappling with undernutrition, where we still have a number of children, especially under the ages of 5, who are stunted or they are suffering from wasting or they are underweight. So we still have that end of the spectrum as a challenge. equally, we now have a rising number of people who are dealing with overweight and obesity-related issues, especially in our urban areas, especially where the consumption of what we call junk foods is much more prevalent. And, you know, this is something that we find not just in middle classes or upper classes, but even in the urban poor. I have worked for several years on programs that focus on the urban poor. And even in urban poor settlements, there is a tendency, you know, for children and for families to be consuming this junk food because it's simply much more easily accessible. And you know, to actually prepare a nutritious meal is not only more difficult, but it can also be more expensive. So you end up finding that, you know, children are having a lot of these junk foods, whether it's packets of chips or chocolates or biscuits. And so we are also grappling with this issue of overweight and obesity. So I think that is what makes it very complex for us, because we are dealing with both ends of the spectrum, undernutrition on the one side, and then clearly overnutrition and the wrong type of nutrition on the other end of the spectrum. Now, of course, there are a few key elements that we need to focus on, and we are also trying to focus on these from the policy perspective. In fact, over the last few years, the central government has launched a major program called the Poshan Abhiyan, which has now recently been, it's been relaunched as a program called Mission Poshan 2.0. But really, there are a few elements in these programs which are critical, which we do need to focus on much more strongly. The most important being behavior change, because when it comes to nutrition, it is not enough, as I said, to just get the supply of food to a family or to a household. They need to be aware and they need to be educated about what is the right balance of nutrients, what are the different kinds of foods that they should be consuming. And of course, this has to be catered to their local context. So if I'm living in a village, in a particular district, in a particular state, obviously the kind of food choices that I make have to be relevant to my context, my cultural context as well, my social context, my food preferences. So taking all that into account, we need to bring about behavior change, which is basically a shift towards more healthy and more nutritious food choices. And that is something we need to ensure with working with communities, with local communities, working with mothers. Mothers obviously have a very, very important role to play, because as we know, in households, in the upbringing of children, women have a very, very, very important say. So we need to work with women, but also other, you know, members of the community, local leaders, you know, community leaders who people, voices people are likely to listen to and trust, to make sure that we create this awareness about what are the healthy and nutritious food choices. And these choices need to be given, you know, right from the start of the life cycle, you know, so right from when you're looking at an adolescent girl, you know, who then obviously goes on to become a mother, and then she has her, you know, newborn child. At every stage of this life cycle, the kind of nutrition that is provided, ultimately, this is how we can break this, what we call this intergenerational cycle of malnutrition that we are grappling with. So behavior change is one very, very big component. And in fact, that is where the Poshan Abhiyan has included a component called Jan Andolan, which basically means that how do we make nutrition and addressing malnutrition a mass movement, a community-led movement? Because the government alone cannot address this. You know, it's not enough for the government to just tell people that this is what you should be eating or this is what your food choices should be. It is something which has to come from people themselves, and communities themselves have to be empowered to make those choices. So that is one big element. The other, of course, is of convergence. And I think this is a big challenge in the policy space in general. That we look at nutrition separately, we look at health separately, we look at water sanitation separately, you know, gender comes under a separate ministry, environment comes under a separate ministry. So we need to somewhere break these silos, because otherwise, you know, all the determinants of nutrition are not food alone. You know, it's not just food. It is also access to water sanitation, right? So because if I don't have access to clean drinking water or to sanitation, I'm going to frequently fall sick. And if I frequently fall sick, it's ultimately going to affect my nutritional status. It's going to affect my immune system. So everything is linked to each other. And that is the kind of linkages that we need to reflect in our policy making, but also in the implementation of programs, because as of now, programs are mostly implemented in silos. So that is a big challenge that we are trying to address through some of these umbrella initiatives like the Poshan Abhiyan, or, you know, now Mission Poshan, that we want to try and bring about this intersectoral, interministerial convergence. So that is the second very big element. The third is, how can we use technology more effectively? And this becomes especially more relevant in the post-COVID era, where, you know, it will often not be possible to have in-person awareness or counseling sessions, you know, the kind of mothers meetings that, you know, we would normally have at a community level. It might be much more difficult, you know, in the middle of a pandemic, or, you know, even after that, our way of living could change substantially. So we need to be able to leverage technology much more effectively to get these messages out to communities, to get them to communities in a language and a format that they understand and they resonate with. This is very important, you know, because we often talk of technology, but it's not technology for the sake of technology. Technology is an enabler, and it is an enabler to allow us to deliver our core programs more effectively. So if we use it in the right way, if we develop content in the right format, if we develop it in different local languages for a country like India, that is very, very important, then it can actually reach out to people and it can resonate with people across the country. So that is another very, very important piece that we are trying to focus on through these programs, through the policy level interventions. And that is something that I believe in the post-COVID era, we are going to see greater use of technology in general. The fourth very, very critical pillar is our frontline workers, our Anganwadi workers, our frontline health workers, because as I said, ultimately, we need this convergence, you know, between an Asha, between an Anganwadi worker, we need this convergence to happen. So how we look at the responsibilities of our frontline workers, how do we compensate them? How do we incentivize them? A lot of our frontline workers are very overburdened. They have a lot of tasks that they need to implement. So we need to streamline all those things. We need to, of course, increase the numbers, but we also need to streamline. We need to bring in other cadres of health workers, of public health professionals who can help us in bringing about this behavior change, which is so crucial. So I think these are some very, very critical elements, which from the government's perspective, the policy perspective, we need to have in place if we are to deliver effectively on our mandate of addressing malnutrition. And as I said, it's absolutely critical. We cannot think that we will have a certain GDP growth or we will have our economy at a certain level until and unless we address malnutrition in childhood as well as adult malnutrition, and address both ends of the spectrum, you know, the undernutrition as well as the overweight and obesity, which is also a big factor for the rise in non-communicable diseases that we are seeing in our country. And that's where I say that, you know, everything is linked, because ultimately, if somebody is obese, they are overweight, they are also at higher risk of developing a lot of lifestyle disorders, cardiovascular ailments, diabetes, etc. So I think we need to think of nutrition in this very, very holistic manner. And as I said at the beginning, that the government alone cannot achieve these objectives. You know, the communities themselves have a very, very key role to play. And we must, as much as possible, try and build the capacity of local communities, try and give them ownership of these initiatives so that they are the ones who can lead it and they are the ones who can take it forward, because governments cannot be there all the time everywhere, and they cannot necessarily ensure the sustainability of a program beyond a point. It has to be taken over by the communities themselves. The other very critical set of stakeholders are the private sector, are the civil society. And I think when we talk of SDGs SDGs in general, we know that these stakeholders have a very, very important role to play, whether it is in terms of bringing in new technologies or whether in terms of bringing in that know-how, you know, the cutting edge knowledge, the research. So academia, civil society, private sector, they all have a very big role to play working alongside the government in addressing this particular challenge. The other element of this SDG, which is very critical, is on agriculture. It is obviously very closely related to nutrition, to hunger. And again, that is a big challenge at the policy level, because we have a separate ministry, which is looking at agriculture. We have a separate ministry which actually looks at nutrition. And this is what I meant by the need for greater convergence. And of course, we've tried to do it under programs like the Poshan Abhiyan. We've tried to bring these ministries on the same table. But to actually get that convergence to happen in reality, it's going to need a lot more effort. Because historically, you know, everyone is used to working in silos. So agriculture becomes very, very important. We also need to think more and more of sustainable agricultural practices, because there is a huge strain on our resources, our water resources, for instance. You know, there is a huge strain over there. So the kind of agricultural practices we adopt, the sustainability also becomes very crucial. And it is, of course, directly linked to the nutritional outcomes as well. The type of crops that we decide to grow. For instance, you know, if there is a push to move more towards healthier options like millets, which also happen to be more sustainable, they also happen to be more environmentally friendly. So I think those are the kind of linkages, you know, across sectors that we really need to bring about. And from a policy perspective, that is obviously one of our biggest focus areas, that how do we drive this greater collaboration across sectors, this greater convergence, and not just at the central level, because as I said, that when it comes to SDGs, states have a very crucial role to play. In fact, much of the action in a federal country like India lies in the states. When it comes to actual implementation of policies and programs. So when we are talking of this convergence, or we are talking of any of these elements, we need to equally look at it at the state and the sub-state levels. And therefore, a lot of our focus needs to go in that direction in terms of how do we build this capacity at the state and even the sub-state levels, because in India, even states are often too large, a population to really be thinking about. And we need to think about much smaller units within the state. So I think those are some of the very, very crucial issues for us when we look at it from the government's point of view, from the policy point of view. But as I said, that the most important is a clear understanding amongst all stakeholders that nutrition, malnutrition is not just critical as a social sector, is not just critical for society. It is equally crucial for our economy, because I believe that once that fundamental understanding comes across all stakeholders, we will start to give priority to the sector that it deserves. Otherwise, we sometimes talk about it, you know, just in a particular context. But I feel that, you know, next time we're talking about our GDP, we should actually ask, okay, how are we doing on nutrition? Because we cannot do well, you know, on our GDP, we cannot do well as an economy, we cannot do well as a workforce, if we are not doing well on nutrition, if we are not doing well on health. So these are some very, very crucial indicators that we need to look at. And within this sector, especially the marginalized groups, that is where our focus needs to be. There are a lot of groups which are marginalized for various socioeconomic reasons, and we need separate and specific targeted strategies for these groups. We also need to look at the gender related aspects, you know, because one thing I find is that we only think of women, in the whole nutrition cycle from a very reproductive, you know, point of view. We just think of women in that role, right? That, you know, women, adolescent girls, you know, will eventually go on to be mothers, and then they will have children. And that is, of course, true. But even apart from that, you know, just women's health, women's nutrition needs to take on much more focus and needs to be a very specific focus area, in my view. It cannot always be from the lens of reproduction. It has to be from a much more holistic and broader lens. So I think that is, you know, I don't want to refer to women as a marginalized group. I mean, that would just not be correct, but it is definitely a group that needs a lot of attention. And again, not just because of their role in the life cycle or in the reproductive cycle, but much more holistically looking at women's nutrition. Similarly, for the elderly, this is another segment, you know, where I think we need targeted attention. Because yes, we think of India as a young country. Yes, we talk of the demographic dividend, but we are also an aging population. The number of senior citizens in the country is also increasing significantly. So how do we think about their nutrition? And what are the kind of specific requirements that they would have? That is, again, something that I feel needs a sort of targeted attention as well as set of interventions. So I think we need to have these specific groups. You know, we already have a lot of focus on children, adolescents, women, but a lot of this focus tends to relate to women of childbearing age. As I said, it needs to be much broader than that. We also need to look at socioeconomically marginalized groups. And we also need to look at the elderly, the senior citizens. How do we think about nutrition for all these different groups? So I think that is another added element that we do need to bring in. Even when we talk of the SDGs and we break down the overarching goal into more granular targets, these targets must take into account all these differences, you know, that are there in the nutritional status of different population groups. And what are the strategies, what are the interventions that we can introduce to address each of these? So I think those are, you know, really some of the remarks and the comments I wanted to make. As I said, I've tried to address it from the policy point of view, from the overarching high level point of view in terms of what do we need to address in this SDG, what are the focus areas, what are the types of enablers and interventions we really need to look at. And of course, ultimately, the fact that this SDG is critical, not just for society, but also for the economy. We cannot progress, our workforce cannot go forward until and unless they are healthy, they are well nourished. And we need the close collaboration across all stakeholders, whether it's private, whether it's public, whether it's civil society, whether it's individuals. I think school children, students, everybody has a very, very big role to play, you know, even in terms of whether it's just advocacy or whether getting the right message out, facilitating behavior change. As I said, behavior change comes best from communities within you know, themselves, right? Because we are much more likely to listen to and trust people who we know well. We are much more likely to be confident in what they tell us. So a lot of these changes need to come from communities, from people themselves, rather than, you know, somebody from the outside coming in and saying, you know, we should be doing this or we should be doing that. So I think these are really some of the points I wanted to highlight today. Thank you once again for giving me this opportunity. It's really been a pleasure to be here and discuss this very, very crucial topic. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Ms. Urvashi Prasad, for joining us today and sharing the Indian perspective. As you rightly said, we need to focus on bringing about the behavioral change and also on creating awareness about healthy and nutritional food. And great to know about Mission Portion of Abhiyan. And as you said, it's not just food and nutrition. And like the SDGs, everything is linked to each other. And I think awareness is very important to the common man. And as you said, technology and social media, let's use it to spread more and more awareness about these crucial points. So GCPIT will always be there to support you in this mission. Thank you so much for joining us. Thank you.